We are here at the harbor of Aarhus, which is the largest port of Denmark. The harbor symbolizes the role of the city as an economic hub. Like most cities today, Aarhus is a center of production with a wide range of industries, businesses, and services. The production and exchange of goods creates wealth, sustains urban life, and attracts people. To some extent, the situation was not much different in antiquity. Ancient cities were centers of production too, and trade played a significant role in the economic life of the cities. Yet, in some important aspects, the situation differed from what we experience today. In antiquity, goods that were produced in the cities and exchanged on a regional and supra-regional level were not the main source of revenue for the cities. Most of the resources that sustained ancient cities were created by the exploitation of the countryside. The urban elites were rich landowners. Their income derived from agricultural production, not from manufacturing, trading, or banking. They sold the surpluses of their agricultural production on the market and invested the revenues in the city. Because of this dependence on agricultural production, the famous sociologist Max Weber drew a clear line between ancient cities and medieval and modern European cities. He labeled ancient cities as consumer cities and the later cities as producer cities. Historians have further developed and refined the original model of Max Weber. In recent years, it has come under attack from various sides, but it still is important to understand the basic economic foundation of ancient urbanism. The main assumption is that cities and the countryside were closely connected in antiquity. And indeed, we can see that cities commanded over large territories with estates, villages, and even towns. The city of Athens, for example, included the large territory of Attica. This territory and the city were inextricably linked and part of the same administrative, juridical, religious, and economic network. Athens was not only the physical space of the city of Athens, but the urban center plus the countryside. The same applies to most cities in antiquity. The economic resources of the countryside, however, were largely under control of rich landowners who resided in the cities. They retrieved rents and extracted surpluses from the sale of agricultural produce. The money they earned, they spent in the cities. This allowed the cities to exist and to thrive. Artisans and services in the city were to a large degree dependent on the spendings of the rich elites. In this system, the relation between cities and the countryside is non-reciprocal. This means that peasants, workers, or slaves in the countryside did not participate in the profits from agricultural production. So the cities and their inhabitants withdrew and consumed the resources of the countryside. This was, according to the model of Max Weber, the economic foundation of the ancient city. The system changed only in medieval times when cities did not command over the surrounding territories anymore. The city dwellers had to produce goods and trade those goods with the people in the countryside to secure food supply. Consequently, in these medieval towns, the relation between city and countryside was reciprocal. The model of the consumer city is very helpful to understand the mechanisms of ancient urban economy. Yet reality was more complex. On the one hand, archaeology can show us that manufacture and trade played a much more important role than has previously been assumed. A new middle class of artisans and merchants emerged that created revenues that did not come from agriculture. Yet we have to keep in mind that the revenues from agriculture were always much more substantial. On the other side, we see in the archaeological evidence that the countryside was more integrated in the markets than the model predicts. The case of Antioch and its hinterland is a case in point.
Antioch was the capital of the ancient province of Syria and one of the largest cities in the ancient world. The city commanded over a very large territory, and we know from the literary sources that the urban elites that embellished the city with monumental buildings relied heavily on the revenue of their rural estates. In the countryside of Antioch, the well-preserved remains of hundreds of villages convey a more nuanced picture. Most spectacular are the so-called dead cities in northwest Syria. In late antiquity, they produced olive oil and wine on a large scale. Wine and oil presses, some of almost industrial scale, attest to the large scale of the production. The surpluses were sold to Antioch and from there to other parts of the Roman Empire. Yet, contrary to the consumer city model, the local farmers benefited considerably from the local and regional trade. They built lavish houses, churches, and bath buildings. Moreover, they had access to a wide range of luxury goods. Inscriptions found in the villages tell us that the estates were not controlled by the urban elites, but by free peasants.
Consequently, the example of the villages in the countryside of Antioch bespeak a reciprocal relation between city and rural hinterland and contradicts the model of the consumer city by Max Weber. To conclude, you should keep in mind that the economy and the success of ancient cities relied to a large degree on the exploitation of the countryside. The leading rich families of the cities derived their income not from production in the city, but from agricultural production. The one-way flow of food from the rural hinterlands to the cities were the economic foundation of these cities. The distribution and redistribution of food created surpluses that allowed craft production and the service sector to thrive. Because of the non-reciprocal relation between the city and the hinterland, ancient cities have been labeled consumer cities.